So how's your week been, Crofty?
Busy.
Yeah, I've been having something of a hell week myself, as you might have figured out from me repeatedly talking to you about me having sinusitis, which has not been particularly fun when I'm trying to research a podcast, but...
This isn't going to be an advert for some sort of sinusitis cure, is it?
Yes, buy Sinex. It will completely ruin your throat and not actually fix the problem, but yes. So, hello everybody, welcome to Mythological. I am, of course, Charles, also known as the Histocrat, and I'm here today with my that was a great way of reading that out. And I'm here today with my increasingly Welsh cohort, Crofty.
And I can't actually respond to that in Welsh like I was going to.
I was going to say, you've not been there that long, so I would be quite impressed if you'd managed to learn that much of the Welsh language.
No, at the moment I can say "haki hook," and that's about it.
Hmm. I will not translate that to have got we're supposed to be a clean tag podcast.
Yeah.
Yeah, we might have to bleep that out when this goes into syndication in Wales.
Maybe.
So, hello everybody, this is Mythological, the show which covers all things mythology, and for today at least, we're also going to be throwing in a little bit of kind of what I'd like to call urban myth, or urban legend, or even folklore, you could say. So, Crofty, what month is it?
It is the month of October.
Yeah, so part of me was thinking, it's October, we're recording towards the end of the month. Maybe, just maybe, this should be on Halloween. But then I thought, that sounds like a big topic. I'm really busy trying to edit my second Birth of Civilization video at the moment. So let's do something a bit more bite-sized. Let's do something that's keeping with the spirit of Halloween, but something that we probably could cover quite quickly. And of course, as usual for this podcast, that completely spiraled out of control very quickly.
Yeah, we're getting into the habit of that, aren't we?
Yeah, I think... Luckily for us, the people who've listened so far seem to be quite accepting that we are the sort of people who, we like our detail and we like to waffle on at length about topics that we've spent a lot of time researching. So hopefully they will forgive us for today as well, because we started out thinking this will maybe be an hour long. And from my notes page, I'm looking here at this, my notes page is twice as long as the Baba Yaga episode we just did. So hopefully... we'll be able to summarise a bit more.
And let's hopefully not have a two-parter.
So, we've been vague so far. Crofty, do you want to introduce today's topic?
Yes, today's topic is the tale of Spring-Heeled Jack, the Terror of London.
Yes, this is a bit of a an interesting one. I think neither of us were very familiar with this coming in. We could have done something like, as I say, Halloween, The Wild Hunt, or... anything else that was kind of more directly like ghost story or mythology based, like All Hallows Eve, etc. Instead, I think we picked one that for a long time kind of lapsed in terms of popularity and has only really started coming back in kind of the last, you know, 20 years or so in mainstream culture.
Yes, I, for one, only heard of it within the last, 6 to 10 years or so.
Yeah. So, it's probably good for us to start out, before we say anything about the character himself, by saying, as we have with previous episodes, what was our familiarity with this? So I'll go ahead first. I actually had a reasonable amount of knowledge about Spring-Heeled Jack, not in terms of the actual mythology of this character. So for those of you who don't know, Spring-Heeled Jack is a character who originated in the early 19th century in London. And who has gone on to kind of become a part of British folklore. Similar to, you know, your Beast of Bodmin Moor, your Bargest, etc. Style figure. So my knowledge was completely disconnected from this. I first encountered the name Spring-Heeled Jack from playing the video game The Elder Scrolls IV Oblivion, in which the boots of Spring-Heeled Jack appear as a plot point for one of the kind of quest lines where you have to get the boots of Spring-Heeled Jack to survive an impossible fall whilst pulling off a daring heist. But outside of that, I had a little bit of familiarity of him. I don't know about you, Crofty. When I was kind of in my late teens, like 17, 18 years old, I went through a phase where I would trawl through lists of cryptids on Wikipedia. And that's where I kind of came across Spring-Heeled Jack. I'd never really read much into him beyond that point. And I think beyond that as well, you might be familiar with one of our D&D games, a particular version of Dungeons & Dragons called Pathfinder, where I actually used Springheel Jack as a monster.
I was going to say that was my first encounter with the name Springheel Jack, our little pirate crew on a mysterious island and some strange jumping, fire-breathing fey creature.
Yeah, I threw that in thinking, oh, this might seem a bit trite and stereotypical. But I was quite surprised to find out, I think, as far as I could tell, no one in the game had ever heard of it apart from me at the time.
Yeah, I don't think we had.
So I was like, oh, I'm actually being more original than I thought. Or at least I'm being quite niche in my my theft.
Yeah, I wasn't aware of it at the time. I only really discovered it as a character of, you know, British folklore, when I later on stumbled across a book in Waterstones, The Strange Affair of Springheeled Jack.
Aha, yes. This is, I would say, probably where most people nowadays would be familiar with the name from. This is the fantasy novel by Mark Hodder, I believe.
Yeah, that's correct.
And I will admit, I haven't read this, Crofty, so I'm kind of in the dark as to how it treats the legend.
It, from what I've read since then, in terms of the actual sightings, it is very it's very true to what's been reported.
Mm-hmm.
And similarly, it does make references to some of the major suspects. For example, it does make reference to the antics of the Marquis of Waterford in Melton Mowbray, for example.
Yeah, so before we go any further, Crofty, we should probably mention that in addition to kind of the folklore nature of this figure, there is also something almost of like a bit of a true crime element running through this as well. We actually have a folkloric kind of urban legend monster figure, but there are actual newspaper accounts from the time that this seems to have been inspired by.
Yes. There's a few reports of actual physical assaults and such by Jack or by similar figures. So there may be a connection to actual real criminals that were just never really brought to account.
Yeah, we'll get into that. So I think we've gone far enough as we can, Crofty, without giving a proper overview of what Springheeled Jack actually is. So the major characteristics of Springheeled Jack in his most developed form that I could find are that Springheeled Jack is a tall, sometimes exceptionally tall figure who's marked by his fin physique and extreme agility. In addition to this, he has a devil-like appearance, red eyes, and he's frequently clothed in a large black cloak that envelops his whole body. In some of the accounts that I read, Crofty, I don't know about you, there's a lot of kind of points made on the fact that he can seemingly change the colour of his clothing at will. So in some versions, he's wearing like white oilskin style clothing. In others, he's dressed in all black, and he kind of switches between the two. Going beyond that, the more iconic traits that are associated with him are, firstly, he is known to attack victims by breathing a large quantity of blue fire into their face. And he's also marked by the large metallic claws that he either, in some accounts, wears on his hands or simply are part of his hands in others, that he uses to shred his victims' clothes. And then the final and the most distinguishing feature of all of him is his ability to leap huge, inhuman distances. So many of these accounts will say, oh, he's leapt over a 6-foot gate, he's leapt 10, 15 feet, etc. And the reason for this is given in some accounts, either it's his own natural ability to do so, or it's due to his eponymous spring-heeled shoes, which, easily became the most integral part of the character, I think, as shown by the name. So before we get into this, Crofty, I want to start by mentioning quickly what my sources are for today's episode. I kind of had a little bit of difficulty initially because there's kind of a disparate nature of works on Springheeled Jack. Some of them are a little more suspect and conjecture-based than others, but the first source I consulted was just a simple overview article by, I think it's Gabriella Bromley, on the website unresolved.me. She had quite a good breakdown of Springheeled Jack just for the kind of entryman. Moving beyond that, I also consulted an article by Mike Dash, who I think is an independent historian, who wrote the article Springheeled Jack to Victorian Boogaboo, or Boogaboo from Suburban Ghost. That's a very good breakdown of all the major sightings and incidents for Spring-Heeled Jack with a strong academic focus. And I also supplemented this by reading some portions of the book, The Legend of Spring-Heeled Jack, that's by Carl Bell, and that I actually would quite highly recommend. It can be a little florid in its language, a little difficult, but I found the information in there is very worthwhile.
My main source was a book called Spirits of an Industrial Age, Ghost Impersonation, Spring-Heeled Jack and Victorian Society by a historian called Jacob Middleton. I supplemented this. I also had the Kindle edition of Spring-Heeled Jack by George Dudding, who's a paranormal writer, also written on subjects such as Bigfoot and Mothman. And also did manage to find some of the original articles, such as from the Morning Post newspaper, and actually a transcript of a trial at the Old Bailey that I'll be going into later on.
Yeah, that's impressive. So I did myself most of the kind of initial newspaper articles that I'm going to be quoting from today. I got them largely from Mike Dash's article. I did go through some archives and managed to find a few of them there, but it's quite difficult to track down because a lot of them are in local papers. And even then, many of these are from, 1830s, 1870s, etc. So it's a little difficult to track down these sources. So that's where I'm largely getting mine from.
Yeah, a lot of my newspaper quotes are from the Jacob Middleton book, just with some of his references. I was quite lucky in that they are available online. Some people had transcribed and uploaded some of these Morning Post articles, and the Old Bailey, the courthouse in London, actually did upload a lot of trial transcripts from around that time.
Yeah, so that's where we're coming from. That's where our sources. But before we get into the main body of today's episode, I'd just like to remind you guys that if you want to, you can support this show on Patreon. Particularly, I'm running a small Patreon at patreon.com/the_histocrat. This is the same Patreon that helps to support my main channel as well. You can find me on YouTube as The Histocrat. So if you ever want to throw anything that way, it will go towards helping us just generally out with the quality of the recording for this show. In particular, we're looking forward at some point, if we can try and get Crofty kind of the same microphone I'm working on, that would be a nice little boost to have for the show. In addition to this, you may be listening to this show on Libsyn under the Mythological tab, or on Spotify or Apple Podcasts. You can also find it on YouTube under the Histocrat YouTube channel as well. So if you'd like to see a few of the kind of visual elements associated with this show, so I might show some clippings from the newspaper accounts, etc., some of the images from newspapers at the time, then you can find those there as well. Okay, so I think that's everything. Crofty, do we want to get started then?
Yes. So we'll have a bit of a preamble on the belief in ghosts, phantoms, and paranormal around the time, and some of the societal conditions in London in the late 18th, early 19th century.
Yeah, we felt it was very important to set the scene really here to the circumstances that would have led to this particular figure's emergence.
Yes, yes. And then we've both got a few related figures that sort of served as precursors to the main Spring-Heeled Jack appearances, where we will see sort of the development of some of his main traits as well before going on to Spring-Heeled Jack himself. So, to begin with, as I mentioned, the idea of the belief in ghosts, as Spring-Heeled Jack and many of the similar figures are referred to as ghosts, even though what most people would think of as a ghost does not in any way match how Spring-Heeled Jack was seen. Spring-Heeled Jack obviously was a very corporeal being by all accounts, as he was known to physically attack people, according to the reports, whereas a lot of our expectations of ghosts are translucent, spectral beings that don't really have any form of physical presence. And that idea of ghosts was quite popular until sort of the mid-18th century. It's the sort of ghost that you would see in Gothic literature of the time, often haunting ancestral homes and usually attached to some form of reason to stay in the physical world, due to a regret or a violent death that needed solving and such like. And in fact, the belief in these ghosts was strong enough that there was one particular case in Scotland in which a man was supposedly informed of the location of a body by the ghost of the deceased, and this was accepted as testimony in court at the murderer's trial. The murderer got off, but it was still actually admitted into the court proceedings as a true account. This idea of ghosts that would be sort of trapped here due to various reasons, in some ways fit into the Christian theology of the time. They sort of viewed it as an equivalent of purgatory, though Protestantism sort of opposed that, as purgatory was more a Catholic idea. And so that's sort of where ghosts are towards the early 18th century. Obviously, the 18th century, also the time of what's known as the Enlightenment, was seeing a lot of advances in terms of science, in terms of philosophy, in terms of rationalizing the material world versus what religion teaches us, and later on, the Industrial Revolution that we'll get to in a minute. So amongst the upper and middle classes, education is becoming much more comprehensive, it's becoming much more widespread. Educated Christians are now seeing God as separate from the mechanistic real world, in that the idea that he created the world and the governing mechanics of the world, but then, with the obvious exception of sending his son, didn't really interfere any further.
Yeah, this is kind of the birth of the age of almost what was called deism as well, which was very popular amongst the nobility in, I think, in the Americas as well, towards the end of the 18th century.
Yeah, and so because of these sort of ideas, the belief in supernatural did sort of begin to wane. The idea that unexplained phenomena were supernatural in nature did sort of fall out of favour, because people were starting to look for evidence and science was becoming much more commonly known, at least among the educated classes. So the idea of spirits and ghosts was starting to be dismissed as superstition of more uneducated classes.
Yeah, I think that's going to be a recurring theme today, is kind of the tension between the kind of more metropolitan elites and both the more working classes and the kind of more rural peoples of the era. This kind of attitude, this kind of march to reason, I think, is kind of a key backdrop to kind of the early 19th century and, you say, late 18th century.
Yeah, that's right. Like, around about this time, obviously with the Industrial Revolution beginning, that's sort of where advances in science actually started to affect the working class. Mm-hmm. Even though they weren't yet being given the education to truly understand it, it was beginning to change their lives. Whereas before, science was very much the thing of educated upper class people. Whereas now, the working class were expected to use, you know, machines and technology, and it was encroaching on the more rural way of life to make way for cities.
Yeah.
So from like the mid 18th century, we're starting to see cities, particularly London, expanding quite a lot, as well as a lot of northern and midland cities such as Manchester, Leeds, Sheffield and Birmingham, where industry is really taking off and where a lot of the work that would normally take a lot more people out in the rural areas, because of machinery being made that can make it easier, there's less work in the rural areas and people having to move to cities to work in manufacturing.
Yeah, and as we will see, that in itself became a problem later on, particularly in the next 50 years or so.
Yes, and as well as people moving to the cities, getting larger and starting to swallow up the smaller surrounding villages, which does also become a problem in one of the stories that I'll be going into. Mm-hmm. So around this sort of time, as the Industrial Revolution is beginning, as things are changing for the working classes, things are changing for the aristocracy as well. There's obviously this increased focus on city life, particularly again in London. A lot of the aristocrats are now living in townhouses rather than on their country estates. They've got increased wealth due to things such as the expansion of the British Empire, the activities of the East India Company, and such like. And so you've got a lot of young, rich men living in close quarters in London, with very little to occupy their time. So they would tend to congregate in a lot of drinking clubs, specifically for upper-class people. They would drink and party together, and they were reported to start setting each other challenges, generally to commit a certain number of acts of petty vandalism, theft, or disguising themselves in order to scare working-class people. And this started around 1712, but was quite popular until the 1760s at least. This group were known as the Mohawks, which was after a gentleman's club, the Mohawk Club, which they supposedly originated from, though the name of the club was derived from the Mohawk tribe of America. One particularly common thing for these men, which it was sort of glossed over in the papers because it was considered an indelicate matter, and that they were reported to be committing quite a large number of sexual assaults. The reports generally included ripping off women's clothes, but then left it at that.
Yeah, I think that's something we should mention as well is, obviously this is still an era of very different sensibilities. So the way that a lot of these incidents are reported, there is a certain amount of speaking around the issue, it appears, in some of these accounts. So sometimes it's difficult to understand the extent of what actually occurred in some of these incidents.
Yeah, yeah. There are a few cases where, that we will go into later, where there was an actual either criminal proceedings against someone, or the story became widely enough known that there are more details, and we will give a warning if we're going to go into detail on that. So, back to the Mohawk group. These men who were from rich backgrounds, they were described by one newspaper as able to commit any offence from slaying a man with excessive drink to running away with a door knocker and meet no worse punishment than a fine. And obviously, due to their wealth, all these men could easily afford any fine given to them by the courts. They could even pay off judges in order to avoid a trial, depending on what the offence was. They could pay off the press to keep their names out of papers, and so there was nothing really deterring them. Like I said, the first reports began in 1712, but the rumours of their activities were surfacing for the entire 18th century, particularly in like the 1750s and 1760s, where they were most common. Mm-hmm. And so these different factors, the increasing size of cities, changing the availability of work, and these upper-class drunks preying on them, represented several major upheavals in the lives of the working class and rural people of England. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of loss of livelihoods, a lot of changing, you know, work patterns, sleep patterns, their finances, while also trying to deal with the fact that there's been massive advances in technology that, you know, wouldn't have been thought possible by their parents or their grandparents. And so it's quite a worrying time for the working classes of England. I believe there I should hand over to you, Charles, if you have any more background regarding the Industrial Revolution, or if you want to move on to our first phantom prowler, as it were.
Yeah, I think the only thing I wanted to really add was this is kind of the period where we see London go from, you know, a major centre within Europe to the largest city in the world. Such was the kind of the speed of and pace of the change. So, you know, suddenly London is, as I say, the largest city and the wealthiest city in the world. And in addition to what you were saying, Crofty, you know, the slow push of people into the cities to try and find work. It may sound like people were moving there because that's where the job opportunities were, but the reality was that often the job opportunities weren't there. As you said, the increased use of machines and industry meant that the actual number of people that were required to do tasks that had previously required, you know, scores more people had just vastly reduced down. So you had this kind of movement of people into the cities to look for jobs, but the jobs just weren't there, unfortunately. And this led to an increase in both kind of overcrowding in terms of housing, a increasing things like child mortality because disease was much higher. There was increased starvation and crime. And as you just generally say, it leads to a perception of the working class at this time as just being in a state of great change and great discomfort.
It's definitely an unpleasant time.
Yeah. So I think from here we can really move to what would be the first of the precursor accounts to what eventually became Spring-Heeled Jack. Okay, so I actually have the first of these accounts that we're aware of after the gang which Crofty mentioned. So this was an incident known as the London Monster. So I haven't gone into this in too much detail, but what this basically was a somewhat of a panic during the late 1780s and the early 1790s regarding what at first was, I think, kind of considered like a spectral figure who would approach women that was described basically as a large man. He kind of had a couple of different MOs, and I'm bringing him up because he's quite similar to some of Spring-Heeled Jack's later activities. So this figure would approach women, and then he would either make them smell a flower, which he had in his breast, or just a group of flowers that he had, and then he would stab them in the buttocks. So sometimes, he's described as just approaching them and immediately assaulting them. Sometimes he leads them on into this activity. This incident is kind of interesting in that they may have apprehended the culprit. They may have not. There is some uncertainty. So a man by the name of, I think it's Rinwick Williams, was actually convicted at the time of, I think, of the crime of defacing clothing, which was actually a more serious crime than assault at the time, whether you'd believe that or not. So he was convicted after a woman basically said, "He attacked me," and then she later recognized him and was able to report him. The problem with this was, in his trial, he admitted, "Yes, I had previously encountered this woman," but when it comes to the other attacks, he is known to have had an alibi for some of these. So it's kind of uncertain, you know. He was basically fined and released, and to the best of my knowledge, this event then kind of petered out afterwards. Hello everybody, just Charles here in post. I just wanted to correct a piece of information I just gave there. Rinwick Williams was not fined, as I just said. He was in fact sentenced to a 6-year term at Newgate Prison. So, yeah, a much more substantial sentence than I made out originally. Okay, apologies for that, and back to the episode. So that's a little difficult to tell, you know, was there an actual culprit doing this? Was it kind of one of these, what we'll get into, these kind of urban panics about a figure that may not have actually had that much substance to it? So that's kind of all I really had to say about the London Monster. So that is quite similar in MO to Spring-Heeled Jack in that he was exclusively approaching women, which again will be seen with Spring-Heeled Jack. And also the fact that he's kind of violently assaulting them. And there is a suggestion that the assault is sexual in some nature, I will say there. Okay, that's kind of all I have, Crofty.
Yes, so the London Monster was probably one of the first reports of these kind of activities where it was attributed to a ghost, a phantom, a monster, or a similar supernatural type entity. Mm-hmm. Again, this was mostly the views of the working class, whereas the press, the middle and upper classes, were going to great pains to say that this was a prank or that this was a criminal. So there were quite a few of these, what were termed prowling ghosts or phantom attackers, were phrases coined by the paranormal writer Charles Hoy Fort. And as a whole, they showed quite a lot of common traits across the group. These common traits did include wearing of animal skins, the presence of horns or a tail, obviously the tendency to attack mostly women and tear at clothes, and generally the ability to disappear quite rapidly into the night when anyone tried to alert authorities or call for help. While there were common traits across the group, an individual ghost was often reported as the same ghost, but with different traits with each sighting. For example, in 1801, a ghost was reported in the town of Richmond, southwest of London, who was out at night scaring women. Some accounts described it as all black, with a long tail but otherwise human form. Others described it as all white, except for black hands and a black face, but no demonic features such as a tail. There were some describing it with horns, and various descriptions that were all attributed to this same ghost. So, like I say, most of the educated classes, so the middle class, the upper class, the writers, the press, did tend to dismiss these as hoaxes or pranks, but they did also feature them very commonly in the newspapers and specify that working class people did believe that it was a ghost. And so that very likely contributed quite a lot to the hysteria surrounding them.
Mm-hmm.
There are very few written accounts where the author would actually support the idea that the ghosts were real, or at least that they were real supernatural entities. So you do sort of have to read between the lines a bit to understand how the working classes were viewing this and how the rumour originally was seen as this is a supernatural entity. And these reports weren't limited to just London newspapers either. The furthest afield one that I found was a Scottish paper called the Caledonian Mercury, which featured articles on these very London-centric, at the time, incidents. So, while many of the ghosts showed traits that would later become quite commonly associated with Springhill Jack, there is one in particular that I feel is a very much direct predecessor to Jack, known as the Hammersmith ghost. He came from what was then the village of Hammersmith, which is about 4 miles southwest of central London, and these days is quite a busy district of London.
I was going to say, yeah, that's a very good point to make, is a lot of the hamlets and villages we're going to be mentioning throughout this this kind of story of Springhill Jack, a lot of them were still, you know, at least suburban, perhaps even slightly rural. They had not yet been kind of subsumed into the cities that they were associated with. So there is, again, this, as you say, Crofty, this divide between the big city and the people out more in the sticks and the different attitudes between the two.
Yes, that's it. And Hammersmith in particular was very much on that dividing line. It had been quite a small village up until quite recently at the time, and it didn't even have a parish church until the early 19th century. Didn't have any defining features of a town, such as a town square or well-defined streets. However, it was very well placed in that it was right next to what was then known as the Great West Road, which now, for British listeners, is the A4. It was one of the busiest routes leading towards Bristol, you know, other major cities of the south at the time. And so being so close to London and so close to this road, and also quite close to the River Thames, it was very much a stopping point for travellers. And because of that, it drew more people, you know, to begin to start businesses such as inns, public houses.
Yeah, it's almost the kind of gold rush coming to town of, ooh, we're next to a big trade hub. Let's set up shop here.
Exactly. So it became much busier and did sort of start to get aspects that were associated with the city, such as an increased crime rate, including highwaymen preying on travellers, and a few abandoned buildings becoming a refuge for smugglers. But due to not having that well-defined town centre or particularly well-defined or paved roads, it did still maintain a lot of aspects of a rural village. So it is sort of the perfect environment to create this kind of story. So in the autumn of 1803, which was when the first reported sightings of the Hammersmith ghost were, he was seen around the village in several different guises. This includes a tall figure in a white sheet, a headless horse, a horned man dressed in calf skin, and once he was seen in the form of Napoleon, who was still, obviously, 1803.
Yeah, still emperor of the... Well, he was still first consul of the French at that time. He wasn't even emperor yet, so...
But was still a major threat,
yeah,
to the British. And so, quite a scary figure to see wandering down the street in Hammersmith. One newspaper report claimed that several witnesses had described that his eyes were glowing with light, which is a common trait of Springhill Jack,
yeah,
that he breathed fire, another trait of Springhill Jack, and that he could vanish by sinking into the earth. So these are probably one of the earliest reports of these kinds of traits that became associated with Spring-Heeled Jack. Although there were, even though he could breathe fire, there were no reports of anyone being burned or of any property damage.
Yeah, funny that.
Yeah. It's almost like it was made up. But yes, the most common activities that he was reported doing was just stalking lone women on the streets at night. At this point, I don't think there were even any reports of physical assaults. That came slightly later.
Mm-hmm.
This ghost, unlike many of the ghosts and monsters of the time, did have an origin story. And so before I go into this, I will say that this does include domestic abuse, it does include stalking, and it does include suicide. So you might want to skip the next few minutes if you'd rather not listen to that aspect.
On YouTube, I will stick a time point in to let people skip forward if they want to.
Yeah, should only take about 2, maybe 3 minutes.
Yeah.
So in 1800, there was an Irish immigrant named Thomas Flynn. He worked as a clerk for a draper's within the city of London. His wife of less than 2 months had recently accused him of abuse, and she had taken him before a magistrate in order to get the equivalent of a restraining order against him. She and her family had then moved to Hammersmith in order to get away from him. Over the next few weeks, he managed to track her down. He broke into their house and attacked his wife with a poker when she refused to accept him and take him back. Believing that he killed her, he then fled and was found standing in the middle of the highway, where he then cut his throat with a razor. His wife survived, but he died in hospital 2 days later. In 1800, suicide was still a crime, and so by law, he was denied a Christian burial, and instead, he was given what was considered the most harsh punishment at the time, which was to be buried underneath the highway with a stake through him. The less harsh punishment was to be buried on the north side of the graveyard, which was normally reserved for unbaptized people.
Mm-hmm.
But because of his previous actions, he was considered not even worthy of that kind of burial, and so he was buried beneath the highway with a stake. There were quite a lot of protests from the Irish community over this, and the army actually had to be called in to prevent them from interfering, so this was quite a high-profile thing. And so due to this belief that at the time that the body was the last link between the soul and the material world, and that denying someone a proper Christian burial prevented their soul from truly leaving the world, people who committed suicide were often connected to ghosts and thought to manifest as ghosts, which led to this initial connection between the Hammersmith ghost and Thomas Flynn. In the later accounts where the ghost began attacking women may also have been part of the connection, because of the similarity of the stalking behaviour. So in December that year, the ghost activities did begin to include physical attacks and break-ins on both men and women. So again, possibly a reason to connect it to Thomas Flynn. And with that, that will be the last mention of Thomas Flynn. So these attacks towards the end of middle and end of December did then start to include attacking both men and women. And that's also when we start to see more mentions in the press of the Hammersmith ghost, when men become at risk, because 19th century.
Yeah, unfortunately.
So, to quote the Morning Post, on the 15th of December last, about 10 in the evening, some servants belonging to a brew house in the neighbourhood were returning with a friend from the outskirts of town, where they were met with the ghost, dressed in what they described to resemble the hide of a calf, with a pair of enormously large horns and cloven feet. The men, not altogether liking the appearance of the intruder, turned about and ran off, but the ghost was too nimble for the man whom he overtook. He seized him by the throat and nearly choked him. The fright, together with the ill usage, threw the poor fellow into a fever, from which he has but very lately recovered. So that was the Morning Post in the first week of January the following year. So that gives you an idea of the kind of physicality of these attacks, in that the ghost tried to choke the man and he was not recovered for at least 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
And that was, I think, the first report of physical attacks. The same article did cover some of the less violent instances of the ghost. This included a coach driver a week later in December, who saw a phantom by moonlight gliding over a meadow as he was leaving Hammersmith. The phantom approached and was described as dressed in white, with bladders attached to its feet, shoulders, arms, body and head. So the coachman abandoned his coach and fled back to town. And when he returned with backup of a few dozen stout fellows, they all found the coach abandoned, the horses' harnesses had been cut, and the horses were grazing in a nearby field. Following this, sightings were then reported every evening in the churchyard in Brook Green, which is about half a mile from Hammersmith, with the last sighting being on Monday the 2nd of January, before the article was then published. This last sighting, the ghost was reportedly seen pursuing a heavily pregnant woman. This sighting was by four men in a stagecoach, who made no attempt to help the woman, and reportedly the woman later died of fright. However, the newspapers were reporting these sightings very uncritically, but an author by the name of R.S. Kirby, who wrote a magazine called Kirby's Wonderful and Scientific Museum, was at the same time debunking these accounts. He investigated and found that the pregnant woman of Brook Green was alive and well, and her fright had just been a drunken person chasing her, but she'd got away unharmed. He also investigated the claim of the coachman, but couldn't actually find the coachman who made the claim, and so put it down to newspaper fabrication.
Yeah, I think we're going to have to point out, I think the era we're in, this coincides not only with a big growth of kind of the urban population, it also coincides with a big growth in the metropolitan press and newspapers. So around this era, every paper was desperate for news or gossip of any kind. So for that reason, there is a lot of kind of unscrupulous reporting going on around this time. Frequently, you see accounts, and as we will see with Springheel Jack showing up, where things are reported uncritically. There is no sign of the first-hand witness anywhere. If there is, there is no sign of a corroborating witness. Often one paper will report something and then none of the other papers will report it either. So, yeah, that's going to be a common feature going forward.
Yeah, it is. Some of these attacks were corroborated or were at least plausible, and the victim did come forward. But a lot of these, to our modern minds, could very easily be attributed to a human attacker. For example, there was a brewer's servant named Thomas Groom, who attested that he was attacked by the Hammersmith ghost while walking through the churchyard between 8 and 9 o'clock one night. A figure came from behind the tombstone and tried to strangle him from behind. He attempted to hit the figure, and he felt something that he described as like a greatcoat before the figure fled. But because the figure was so fast, he didn't actually get a good look at him. However, the following month, he did actually attest in court that this attacker was the Hammersmith ghost. And so that brings me to what I mentioned of the trial at the Old Bailey and the events surrounding it. Because of these various reports of attacks, watchmen at this stage were now actively trying to catch the ghost. In early January, a reward of £10, which at the time was several months' wages, had been offered. So on the night of the 3rd of January, 1804, a group of armed young men went hunting for the ghost, prompted by several sightings close to an inn called the White Hart in Hammersmith. One of the hunters, called Francis Smith, agreed to meet with one of the local watchmen, William Girdler, after Girdler had patrolled the Great West Road, while Smith had investigated the nearby narrow lanes close to the Thames, in which the ghost had been thought to haunt. On a road called Cross Lane, which was quite a narrow and unlit street, no more than 4 yards wide, he spotted a figure in white moving towards him, and he called out to the figure, "Damn you, who are you? Stand, else I'll shoot." When the figure ignored him and just carried on approaching, without responding, he fired on the ghost, before fleeing back to the White Hart Inn and having a servant summon Girdler from patrol. On their way back to Cross Lane, they met Smith's neighbour, John Locke, who agreed to assist them. When the three of them got back to Cross Lane, they found a body of a man in a white flannel jacket white trousers and a white apron tied around his waist, with his face and neck destroyed by shotgun pellets. The man was soon identified as Thomas Millwood, as his sister Anne found the group when she was searching for her brother after he didn't return home. So a constable was summoned, and Smith, who was honestly mortified by what he'd done, he willingly submitted to arrest. So on January the 13th, he was tried at the Old Bailey in London, and this was where Thomas Groome gave his account of the Hammersmith ghost as part of the defence to explain the reason why there were armed patrols in the town. Anne Millwood testified that she had first found the body before Smith, Girdler and Locke returned. She'd gone to find help, but didn't find anyone, and then returned to find the three of them around the body. And she also said that she knew of the ghost and the various stories of it appearing in a calfskin outfit or with horns on its head or glass eyes, and so understood why there were armed patrols in the town. Other witnesses, such as relatives of Thomas Millwood, also attested to Smith's good character and that he had no ill intent towards Millwood. The jury initially returned a verdict of manslaughter, but the judge forced them to reconsider and return either guilty or not guilty to murder. So the jury reluctantly returned a verdict of murder. The judge sentenced him to death by hanging. However, due to the public feeling that this was an honest mistake by a man who genuinely thought that he was in danger from a ghost, Smith was granted a royal pardon the next month and he was released. So while after this there's not very many reported sightings of the Hammersmith ghost that year, this goes to show just how much public belief in the ghost could affect things in the two. It was enough for the king to actually consider giving this man a pardon for murder. And so that shows, at the time at least, there was quite strong feeling amongst the public, both on the subject of ghosts and the idea that, yes, this was a plausible threat to Francis Smith, and so discharging his shotgun is reasonable self-defence.
Yeah, it was where, not necessarily that we agree with you that the ghost exists, but more, we agree that you thought you were in danger.
Yeah, exactly. And as a side note, that case has been discussed by judges and legal scholars for 200 years as to whether it is an acceptable precedent for wrongly believing that you're in danger as a defence for murder.
Yeah, I mean, I think that kind of then moves it more into the manslaughter territory, doesn't it?
Yeah, that's it. So the next reports of the Hammersmith ghost, he returned in December 1824. Again, newspapers such as the Morning Post and the Examiner were reporting on instances of him frightening the neighbourhood of Hammersmith for upwards of a month, to the serious injury of many persons. Again, he preferred female victims, and in these reports he started using claws or hooks attached to his hands, another trait that we've mentioned is associated to Spring-Heeled Jack. Some incidents did show some similarity with 1803 and 1804, such as hanging around the graveyard and attempting to strangle people, and fleeing whenever someone resisted. One account did include that he had leapt upon a man's back, dragged him to the ground and broke his arm. And a less violent encounter, again echoing Spring-Heeled Jack later, claimed that a gardener's wife, a Mrs. White, encountered in her doorway a ghostly dressed figure with a large ugly mask and glaring eyeballs. Some flame was then emitted, after which the ghost exclaimed, "Good night, farewell," and decamped with supernatural rapidity. So again, we're now seeing these various traits of Spring-Heeled Jack sort of come together in the Hammersmith ghost.
Yeah, I think we should probably mention that at this point anyway, the initial traits that we'll start talking about for Spring-Heeled Jack soon, they are traits that are somewhat common for a lot of Victorian kind of ghost stories. The flame part really is the kind of more unique part so far. But the being clothed in white sort of image is very much part of the stereotypical Victorian ghost.
Yeah, yeah. And these various traits tend to appear only one of them.
Yeah.
Per account, there wasn't really an account of fire breathing and claws in the same encounter. So it was sort of bits of Spring-Heeled Jack starting to appear before finally coalescing into a single figure who showed all of these traits.
Yeah, it's kind of the development of the kind of devil figure of the Victorian era is what we're seeing going on.
Yeah, and the devil figure leads into the other figure that is thought to either be the Hammersmith ghost just moved elsewhere, or thought to be inspired by the Hammersmith ghost, who introduces us to the final trait of Spring-Heeled Jack that's not yet appeared. So, also in the winter of 1824, in the port city of Southampton in Hampshire, on the south coast of England, another ghost had been reported. Again, it was showing similar activities to the Hammersmith ghost, mostly frightening lone people walking at night. This ghost was more consistent in its appearance than the Hammersmith ghost or previous ghosts had been, with the majority of reports telling of an outfit that was designed to resemble a skeleton. One newspaper account describes a tight white jerkin with ribs and all the paraphernalia of death traced on him with phosphorus. And this account just described him as simply standing motionless for a moment after throwing open his coat to reveal this deathly appearance before fleeing. Another tradesman had reported a man wearing a skeleton underdress, out scaring people at night, and the Hampshire Telegraph reported rumours of this, and reported the final trait of Spring-Heeled Jack that we've not yet seen, and I quote, "Many stories are in circulation about the ghost, as he is called. Some say that he is 10 feet high and can jump half over a house, and all agree that he is a perfect living skeleton." Another late report also claimed he was wearing armour and spring boots, and that he had been shot by 2 or 3 individuals and was found to be invulnerable, being enveloped in steel armour and wearing a pair of spring boots, so constructed to allow him to vault over a 10-foot wall. These accounts, again, no one was ever caught or even accused of being the Hampshire ghost, and after 1825, he disappeared. In 1824, the activities of the Hammersmith ghost again ended with 2 arrests. One was the rumour of an arrest of an aristocrat's son from Kensington in central London, who was playing these pranks for a bet. However, supposedly due to the wealth and influence of his family, that arrest was kept out of the press. The second was a farmer from the nearby town of Alperton, called John Benjamin, who was caught dressed in a white sheet with a hairy cap tied under his chin, making horrendous noises and scaring people. He admitted before the magistrates that he'd appeared as the ghost for a couple of nights recently, but he was blamed for all of the activities of the ghost that winter. And after that, Hammersmith ghost again faded from the public eye. So the Hammersmith ghost did appear once more in 1833, again just with a lot of vague reports of women being attacked with claws and hooks and having their clothes torn off. At this stage, everyone was heavily sceptical or just outright dismissive of any supernatural explanations. The papers shared a rumour in December that year that he'd been caught and was actually a celebrated captain of sporting notoriety, who again escaped punishment due to their money and influence. And unlike the previous 2 years where the ghost had appeared, this time there wasn't the same mass hysteria or panic about him. And it seems that in 1833, he did find a less superstitious population. However, that may change later on in the decade when we hand over to you, Charles, for Spring-Heeled Jack.
Okay, thank you, Crofty. So, I do actually have an additional account as well to add, which kind of leads a little bit into the initial reports of Spring-Heeled Jack. This is a very brief account. It is literally just one incident which occurred. So around the same sort of time, as you say, the later outbreaks, I think, of the Hammersmith ghost, in particular in 1826, there is one report from August in the newspaper of Lloyd's Penny Weekly. And it tells us that a young man by the name of Jack B was out walking along the Commercial Road, which I'm not 100% sure whereabouts around London that's supposed to be. I couldn't find any more information on that. It tells us that this man was attacked by a cloaked and masked man with cloven hooves for feet, who seized him in his arms and squeezed his body against Jack's, when in a moment Jack was on fire. So according to this account, the badly burned victim managed to pull the assailant's mask away and actually discovered him to be his younger brother. Which is weird.
Yeah.
So the reporter concludes this account by basically saying that the doctor called to treat the burns is still alive and can vouch for the truth of this statement. Indeed, poor Jack is still much pained from this affair. So I wanted to single this out for the simple reason that it's a little bit of an odd reversal, and I actually misinterpreted this when I read it initially, that the victim was actually called Jack, of all things. And when I first read it, I thought that this was the first account of Spring-Heeled Jack. But no, in fact, it's referring to the victim in this case.
Yeah, I initially thought that when you said Jack, that was referring to the attacker.
No, so as we'll find, Crofty, it takes quite a while for the name of Jack to emerge. Much like many other incidents, say the most famous Jack of this era, which would be Jack the Ripper, it took quite a while for the name of Jack to actually emerge in that case as well. I think for a while he was actually referred to as Leather Apron before he was Jack the Ripper. But anyway, that's a different podcast for a different audience to us.
Hmm.
So what was interesting to me about hearing those accounts, Crofty, was you mentioned how the Hammersmith ghost and the Southampton ghost slowly take on more and more of these attributes that would be later associated with Spring-Heeled Jack. The initial reports surrounding Spring-Heeled Jack that eventually kind of mutate into him, as far as we can tell, what's interesting about those is they don't really show any of these characteristics. They appear to have been kind of co-opted in at a later date, so it may be a case that they were later influenced by the Hammersmith ghost. But the first reports that we find in like local newspapers from the period where he emerges don't mention any of these traits in particular. So for reference as to what was happening around this time, Crofty, we've discussed kind of what was going on in terms of the growth of London and the Industrial Revolution and how it was changing the landscape of England in many ways. I want to also stress that 1837 in particular was a period of time that was very much would have felt like a change, like the end of an era and the beginning of another one. And there's a few reasons for that. So probably the most important of this is actually the beginning of the Victorian era. So in 1837, King William IV died and Queen Victoria had ascended the throne, I think at the age of 18. So again, it's a major change. As to other major technological developments coming along at that time, so for example, the daguerreotype photograph had been invented that year. So that's the first kind of reliable mass market photography. Charles Dickens was in the process of serialising his second novel, which was Oliver Twist. Later the next year, the People's Charter was issued to call for full male enfranchisement of the working class. This came off the heels of the Great Reform Act of 1832, which had expanded basically the vote to all male property owners, but had still not really expanded out to the working class. And what is going to be a very important development for this story going forward was that in 1829, the Metropolitan Police had been founded. So up until this point, there had been no single police force for the whole of London. It's all been like local police forces, and indeed some of those continued as well.
Yeah, I should specify that when I mentioned summoning a constable, that was more just a locally appointed position, and often in these villages, this constable was the only constable. It wasn't part of a police force or police service.
Yeah, we're kind of almost coming out of an era where the local police constable was probably also the owner of the local inn or some other major societal marker like that. So it is kind of amongst this backdrop that the first account that has really been tied to Spring-Heeled Jack appears. Spring-Heeled Jack is unusual in that a lot of his initial appearances do not appear in kind of newspaper accounts. They kind of appear to have been going around as rumours amongst the working class in a number of rural villages. So many of these villages are now part of London proper. In fact, if you went there and if you are a resident of kind of the Greater London area, you would be able to walk between these areas and you would see no break whatsoever in the city between them. They are completely engulfed by London itself. But at the time of these attacks, these were very much still suburbs, kind of semi-rural areas, very much on the transition point, as you mentioned before. So the first stone report comes from September of 1837, and it comes to us from the village of Barnes, where rumours began to circulate that a ghost in the shape of a large white bull had attacked several persons, particularly women, and that many of these women had suffered great fright as a result, and some of them were not expected to recover their senses. There's not much more to go on than that. As I say, it's rumours, but these rumours seem to have moved very rapidly throughout the remainder of 1837, throughout a succession of these outlying villages. So in East Sheen, this report of a large white bull has become a report suddenly of a white bear. At Richmond, nearby, we again see reports of a ghost, but this time it is described as an unearthly visitant. So it's not explicit, but it's kind of hinting more at this devil figure that we later see and that you were describing with the previous incidents. By the time that this unearthly visitant arrives at the places of Ham and Petersham, he is now suddenly being described as an imp of the evil one. And in Kingston, he is again reported as an alleged supernatural visitant. So from here on, he moves north of the Thames to Hampton Wick and Hampton Court, and we see a sudden transition, Crofty, to something a bit more familiar. So all of a sudden, the rumours are describing this figure as an unearthly warrior clad in armour of polished brass, with spring shoes and large claw gloves. So very suddenly, we see something very similar to the kind of later stages of the Hammersmith and Southampton ghosts, as you say. And there's not, from the accounts that I was reading, the sources, there wasn't like an obvious logical progression between them. It's simply that the rumour seems to have mutated, and personally, I wouldn't be surprised if it was influenced by those prior accounts as well. This human-like figure becomes the more established form by the time he kind of draws closer and closer to the city proper itself. So it's in this guise of an unearthly warrior that he appears in Twickenham, Witton, Hounslow, Isleworth. These are all like little London areas, and I'm not that familiar with London, so I'm probably getting every pronunciation here incorrect. But that's the luxury of not living in London, I guess. I'll take it for the affordable house prices up here, okay?
I'm a big fan of not being in London too.
Yeah.
Just alienate some audience.
Sorry, we are very much Northerners, and so Londoners may look down on us, and we look down on them in turn. So,
fair's fair.
We love Londoners, really. It's not their fault. So, by the time he arrives in Isleworth, this is where we get the first account that's got a named victim who is being assaulted. It's again very brief. It is just an account of a local carpenter by the name of Jones, who around 11 p.m. at a place known as Cutthroat Lane, so that's a warning sign already, he reports that he was attacked by a figure who very much resembled the kind of unearthly warrior that I described before. And when he decided to struggle back, this figure was in fact then joined by two more like it. So this is kind of a unique aspect of this story. None of the ones I have going forward really have more than one culprit. They're all the actions of an individual perpetrator. So he then reports that he was overwhelmed by these figures and they proceeded to cut his clothes to ribbons, although there wasn't any mention in that account that he received any kind of further injury. So that to me, it has very much got something of, you know, the local cut purse ambushing a bloke at night, basically, who was then joined by his conspirators. But anyway, I don't want to read too much into that because obviously there's no more to go on than that, really. So moving beyond there, again, the figure moves through a succession of villages. He appears in Heston, Drayton, Harlington, and eventually in Uxbridge, after which he then moves to Hanwell, Brentford, and Ealing. In Ealing, it's reports that he attacks and severely wounds a blacksmith, and also many other accounts from time claim that he has attacked and torn the clothes, the backs of young women. And then finally, from additional reports in Hammersmith and St. John's Wood, it is claimed that the figure was seen in the guise of a bear, which is interesting to me, Crofty, that in Hammersmith we're getting a very different report.
Yeah. Maybe either perpetrator or press sort of tried to deliberately distinguish it from the Hammersmith ghost, perhaps.
Yeah. Now, I'm trying to look at my notes here. I'm trying to remember. This may have actually been a case where the figure was reported to have been seen wearing a dressed up as a bear rather than a physical bear. So that's just one thing to take into account for that. But that to me kind of suggests, I don't know, that suggests a greater degree of separation between the two figures. That it was initially reported in such a different form in Hammersmith.
Yeah, yeah.
These sightings in these kind of outlying villages continue for several months throughout the remainder of 1837. If you look into this, there is also what's considered like a major account of Spring Hill Jack that emerges around this time in late 1837, specifically on the 11th of October. I haven't really gone into much detail on this, and the reason why is most historians and kind of folklorists think that this is actually an invented account that was created many decades later by an author by the name of Peter Haining. This is known as the Polly Adams case. So this basically purports that a serving girl by that name was attacked on the 11th of October. So this account appears, as I said, in Peter Haining's book. And it's significant in that Polly is able to identify her assailant after the fact. So the exact quote I have here is that the figure, appearing gigantic in the shadows, bounded towards her on legs that covered much distances, with each stride that scarcely seemed human. Behind it swirled a cloak, which billowed and flapped noisily. But above this cloak, it was the face that caught and held Polly's attention. A face that glowed like coals, and a mouth that spat flashes of blue fire. A face from the very depths of hell. A laugh rang out from the creature. A peculiar, ringing laughter. A laugh which she was able to recall later she had heard before that evening. The eyes flashed again, and she saw that they were distended from their sockets, protruding to such a degree that she could see the white of the iris around the dark, menacing spots of the pupils. These eyes, too, she had not seen so long ago. So this account claims that Polly identified this assailant as a nobleman who had propositioned her earlier in the day. And what's really interesting about it is that if it was true, then we immediately see Springheel Jack in all of his kind of developed form appearing early on in the narrative. But as I say, it's considered by most historians that this is not a valid account, that it was made up many decades later. In addition to this particular spurious tale, if you go on the Wikipedia article for Springheel Jack, you'll also see mention of an assault on a figure by the name of Mary Stevens that is very similar to the fully developed version of Springheel Jack. And you'll also see an account where he assaults a passing carriage, similar to one of the Hammersmith, or was it the Southampton ghost stories that you just gave, Crofty?
Yeah, it was the Hammersmith one, the first appearance.
Yeah. What's interesting about these two accounts is, A, none of the sources that I consulted mention them. They appear entirely on the Wikipedia article, as far as I can tell. And interestingly, the Wikipedia articles do not have any citations for them. Yeah, someone's not doing their due diligence there.
Yeah. Cite your sources, people.
Yeah, citation needed. Right, so I'm going to put those accounts aside for the moment and say that up until this point, we've really only ever seen Springheel Jack appearing as a more like stereotypically ghost-like figure who appears as either an animal or to some extent has appeared as a warrior, as we've mentioned before. It's here that the first contemporary newspaper story that references kind of these events appears in the Morning Chronicle on the 28th of December, 1837. So this account doesn't seem to have aroused that much interest by the city itself. At this point, the rumours are still very much suburban in nature. But the story reads the following. It says, "Some scoundrel, disguised in a bearskin and wearing spring shoes, has been seen jumping to and fro before foot passengers in the neighbourhood of Lewisham, and has in one or two instances greatly alarmed females. He has been named Steel Jack by the inhabitants of Lewisham." So that's the first known reference I can find to the perpetrator being called Jack. It's obviously not, you know, Springheel Jack, but that's the first appearance that I could find. And it's also interesting because now, again, we see the spring shoes appearing into the narrative. So it's clear again that the attributes of Jack are beginning to coalesce somewhat. So around this time, in addition to those hoax accounts that I mentioned before, there are some reports that were established to be fabricated even at the time that they occurred. So for example, in Old Brentford, what is described as a respectable son of the town reported to the authorities that he had seen the ghost. Upon investigation, however, it turned out that what he had actually seen was the local police inspector on his horse, which was a white horse, so yeah. In addition to this, there was also a report that an individual similar to Spring-Heeled Jack had been seen dancing by moonlight on the lawn of Kensington Palace, which also turned out to be untrue. My sources did make reference to the fact that it was actually an incident that happened in the 1820s, but I didn't see any more information than that, so there's clearly more of a story behind that. In addition, there's also reports of attacks on what is described as a pie and muffin vendor in Hammersmith, and a report that a woman had been frightened to death by the figure around this time. Both of these were reported later in the papers, but they were both described as hoaxes, though it does not say how they were established as hoaxes, so there's a degree of uncertainty around those stories. But again, when I started, when I kind of put together my research for this, Crofty, I did not realise that some of these earlier accounts actually were in Hammersmith, so it's interesting to see the connection more so.
I believe, was Hammersmith starting to actually fully become part of the city at this stage? Because I know the Hammersmith Bridge was built in, I think, 1824, the bridge over the Thames. So I think that by this point, the city was very much expanding to include Hammersmith.
Yeah, there may be more of an integration going on then there.
Yeah, so rather than it being like a separate group of encounters, like the Hammersmith ghost being separate from the Richmond ghost in the early years of the 19th century, the idea that it is now just less well-defined borders between different regions.
So, as we said before, these rumours had received quite limited publicity outside these local areas up until this point. This very dramatically changes in early 1838. This is a great example of what I would almost call, it's similar to what I call the Streisand effect, where like making a point of denying something and trying to quash it accidentally vastly publicizes the event.
Yeah.
So this was on the 9th of January when the Lord Mayor of London, Sir John Cohen, issued the following proclamation from Manor House. The text of this was reprinted in the Times and reads as such. The Lord Mayor said that he had received a letter upon a subject the odd nature of which had induced him to withhold it from the public for some days, in the expectation that some statement might be made through a source of indisputable authority relative to the matter of which it was treated. So the following is the letter. To the Right Honourable the Lord Mayor, my Lord, the writer presumes that your Lordship will kindly overlook the liberty he has taken in addressing a few lines on a subject which, within the last few weeks, has caused much alarming sensation in the neighbouring villages within 3 and 4 miles of London. It appears that some individuals of, as the writer believes, the higher ranks of life, so yeah, Crofty, nobles again, have laid a wager with a mischievous and foolhardy companion, name as yet unknown, that he does not take upon himself the task of visiting many of the villages near London, in the 3 different disguises of a ghost, a bear, and a devil. And moreover, that he will not dare to enter gentlemen's gardens for the purposes of alarming the inmates of the house. The wager has, however, been accepted, and the unmanly villain has succeeded in depriving 7 ladies of their senses. At one house he rang the bell, and on the servant coming to open the door, this worse than brute stood in a no less dreadful figure than a spectre, clad most perfectly. The consequence was that the poor girl immediately swooned, and has never from that moment been in her senses, but upon seeing any man screams out most violently, take him away. There are 2 ladies, which your lordship will regret to hear, who have husbands and children, and who are not expected to recover, but likely to become burdens upon their families. For fear that your lordship might imagine that the writer exaggerates, he will refrain from mentioning other cases, if anything more melancholy than those he has already related. This affair has been going on for some time, and strange to say, the papers are still silent on the subject. This writer is very unwilling to be unjust towards any man, that he has reason to believe that they have the whole history in their fingers' ends, at their fingers' ends, but through interested motives are induced to remain silent. It is, however, high time that such a detestable nuisance should be put a stop to, and the writer feels assured that your lordship, as the chief magistrate of London, will take great pleasure in exerting your power to bring the villain to justice. Hoping your lordship will pardon the liberty I have taken in writing, I remain your lordship's most humble servant, a resident of Peckham. So the Lord Mayor had an interesting reaction to reading this account. So he observed that, as our friends on the other side of the Atlantic were in the habit of saying, it was extraordinary if true. In his opinion, it was not calculated for the meridian of London, but if any trick can be practiced by fools, he had no doubt that the vigilance of the police might be depended upon to prevent annoyance. It appeared to him that the letter, which was written in a very beautiful hand, was the product of a lady who may have been terrified by some bugaboo into this mode of attaining retribution at the hands of the Lord Mayor. But as this terrible vision has not entered the city, he could not take recognizance of its iniquities. A gentleman present stated to his lordship that the servant girls about Kensington and Hammersmith and Ealing told dreadful stories of the ghost or devil, who on one occasion was said to have beaten a blacksmith and torn his flesh with iron claws, and in others to tear the clothes from the backs of females. Not one of the injured people had been known to tell the story, perhaps they did not live to tell it. So the Lord Mayor believed that one of these seven ladies who had lost their seven senses was in fact his correspondent, and he hoped that she would do him the favour of a call, and he would have the opportunity of getting from her such a description of the demon as to enable to catch him in spite of the paid press and police. So, Crofty, do you pick up the kind of subtext of what's going on here?
Yes. Again, we're seeing this idea that it is all being perpetrated by the aristocracy, as usually as a wager, to frighten the lower classes.
Yeah. So that's quite similar to what you reported before for the, what was the gang called?
The Mohawk Gang.
Yeah, the Mohawk Gang. And what, to me, is kind of interesting, according to many of the sources I was consulting for this, they generally interpret this as the Lord Mayor, this is kind of like, he's kind of mocking this. He's like saying, you know, he's kind of saying like, oh, these ladies who have lost their senses and all these victims, none of them have come forward. Perhaps they didn't live to tell the tale. This to some extent has been interpreted as the big city mayor making fun of the suburbs.
And also does echo a lot of comments that men would make at female accusers.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The general thought of this is the mayor like trying to quash these rumours to some extent and just saying, look, this is silly. If it's real, come and see me. This backfired immediately. What it basically did, as far as I can tell, is it opened the floodgates, and more reports of the activity of this character came flooding in afterwards. The papers took this up as a story, and yeah, this did not have the result that he was expecting. And this is also significant because this is where Spring-Heeled Jack as a character is introduced to the upper echelons of London society. Up until now, it's been some elements of the metropolitan press and rumours going around. Now this is a topic that's discussed by citizens of respectable standing as well. So despite this kind of flood of reports, we still don't really get any correspondence that, you know, is verified and has like a first-hand witness who's willing to stand up behind it that is a reputable source. So that's one thing we just need to keep into account. So for the remainder of January, this figure is referred to in the papers, both as the suburban ghost, so again, very much kind of limiting it to outside of London itself, or simply the ghost. Somewhere between the date of the 14th of January and the 20th of January, however, a somewhat sensationalist paper by the name of the Penny Satirist begins referring to the figure as Spring-Heeled Jack. Up until a week before this, so that's why I said the 14th, other papers had been referring to him as I said, Steel Jack or Suburban Ghost. This name catches on immediately. In a lot of cases, it appears in newspapers in quotation marks to indicate it's been used ironically. So again, many of these papers from the start, as you said with the earlier accounts, Crofty, they put no weight on the supernatural elements of this whatsoever. They push this idea immediately that it's a gang of noblemen who are carrying out these attacks. What's interesting to me about this is, whilst the Lord Mayor didn't take the supernatural elements of the reports he was given seriously, he does take the idea that it could be like a gang of perpetrators or nuisance makers. He takes that element seriously. And in support of this, he starts amassing subscriptions from wealthier citizens to aid in the expense of any prosecutions brought against any individuals apprehended who are causing these disturbances. So this disturbance and the panic around it continues to grow throughout January, and by the later part of the month, we know that a public committee has been set up by a number of concerned citizens, and they are already circulating placards that are offering £10, so you said a considerable sum of money for the period, for the reward for apprehension of any of these parties responsible. So that's the general line that the papers take, that this is a noble gang of, as we said before, sons with nothing to do that are entertaining themselves by dressing up in these series of disguises to cause trouble and entertain themselves. There is one exception, however, which is the penny satirist. So whilst other papers are very much subscribing to this idea, the penny satirist openly mocks the situation and claims that the Bishop of London has clearly come up with the ghost as a hoax in order to scare people back into his pews. So that kind of harkens back, doesn't it, Crofty, to the kind of religious elements you were mentioning earlier on in this episode?
Yeah, sort of trying to keep that superstition of the working class alive, but this time for the benefit of the church.
Yeah, and it's kind of mocking the situation by saying, it's almost playing the other side in that regard, where it's mocking like the bishop himself, rather than necessarily the working class peoples.
Yeah, sort of seeing superstition rather than as the working class's own thing, seeing it as the church trying to manipulate them, essentially.
Yeah, as we say, it is open mockery from a quite sensationalist paper. So by the time we reach the midpoint of February, this kind of public awareness and panic around Springhill Jack is reaching something of a fever pitch. Both the public and the press are increasingly anxious and interested in the figure. The problem, as I said before, though, is up until the 20th of February, we don't have a verifiable report that really would have been able to be taken seriously by the police. That changes on February 20th. This is very much in the sources I was reading referred to as the defining event in the legend of Springhill Jack, and it is known as the Alsop case. So, unlike the previous cases, there's first-hand witnesses, there's a second-hand witnesses, and there is a reputable citizen who is willing to back up this statement as well, and to offer their own reward. On February 21st, a woman by the name of Jane Alsop, her two sisters, and her father, arrived at Lambeth Street Police, where they reported an attack that had occurred the previous day. This account was taken down by a local magistrate, and was heard by both the chief magistrate and also by a reporter for the Morning Chronicle. As a result, the full account, which was far more detailed than any we received previously, was published in both it and several other major papers the next day. And the report reads as follows. Miss Jane Alsop stated that, at about 9:15, she heard a violent ringing at the gate at the front of the house, and on going to the door to see what was the matter, she saw a man standing outside, of whom she inquired what was the matter, and requested that he would not ring so loud. The person instantly replied that he was a policeman, and said, "For God's sake, bring me a light, for we have caught Springhill Jack here in the lane." So she returns further into the house, and brings out a candle, and hands it to the person, who appeared to be enveloped in a long cloak, and whom she at first really believed to be a policeman. The instant she had done so, however, he threw off his outer garment, and applying the lighted candle to his breast, presented a most hideous and frightful appearance, and vomited forth a quantity of blue and white flames from his mouth. His eyes resembled red balls of fire. From the hasty glance, which her fright enabled her to get of his person, she observed that he wore a large helmet, and his dress, which appeared to fit him very tight, seemed to her to resemble white oilskin. Without uttering a sentence, he darted at her, and catching her partly by the dress and the back part of her neck, placed her head under one of his arms, commenced tearing her gown with his claws, which he was certain were some metallic substance. She screamed out as loud as she could for assistance, and by considerable exertion got away from him, and ran towards the house to get in. Her assailant, however, followed her, and caught her on the steps leading to the half-door, when he again used considerable violence, tore her neck and arms with his claws, as well as a quantity of hair from her head. But she was at length rescued from his grasp by one of her sisters. Miss Alsop added that she had suffered considerably all night from the shock that she had sustained, and was then in extreme pain, both from the injury done to her arm, and the wounds and scratches inflicted by the miscreant about her shoulders and neck, with his claws or hands. The rest of this account goes that her sister was able to drag her back into the house and get her away from the assailant, and to close the door on him somehow. After this, however, he continued to pound on the door, and only eventually departed after her sisters called for the police from the upper floor windows. So this account is quite notable, Crofty, because, as I said before, it's very lengthy, it's very detailed, and it's backed up by multiple witnesses, and comes from a respectable middle-class family. So her father stated that he was immediately willing to offer the princely sum of 10 guineas. So for people who aren't familiar with this period, a guinea was roughly the equivalent of £1 and 1 shilling. That he would offer 10 guineas as a reward for any information that would lead to the perpetrator's apprehension. And in addition to this, he was also joined on the 23rd of February by Sir Edward Codrington, MP, who offered a further £5 as reward. The weight of this account, the fact that there were multiple witnesses, led to an actual investigation in this case. We've moved officially past the point where there are rumours going on about this. We are into an actual police investigation. So this took the form of actually two investigations. The first of these was conducted, as I mentioned before, by the recently established Metropolitan Police and by the Lambeth Street Police Force themselves. So this second investigation is probably the more notable of the two because it was led by a celebrated London detective by the name of James Lear, or Lee, I think it is. James Lee was considered easily the best detective of his day. And that was largely because he had solved a notorious murder case during the 19th century, which was known as the Red Barn Murder, where, Crofty, you might have more details on this. The rough account I read of this was basically, I think a man had murdered his wife and then covered it up, and then had basically fled to elsewhere in the country and had started sending letters claiming his wife was with him and he was fine, only for the detectives to discover the body of his wife.
Yeah, that sounds about right to me.
Yeah. So that's one to read into. Apparently that is like considered like one of the defining murder cases of the mid and early 19th century up until obviously the Whitechapel murders later on. So if anyone out there is a fan of true crime, that might be one to go and have a read about. So Lee took this job very seriously. He is reported as being on the job the same day that the crime was reported. And by the end of that day, he had already issued a preliminary statement. And it was reported in the papers as such. He stated that from what they had learned, he had no doubt that the person by whom the outrage had been committed had been in the neighbourhood for nearly a month past, frightening men as well as women, and had on one occasion narrowly escaped apprehension. A person answering precisely to his size and figure had been frequently observed walking about the lanes and lonely places, enveloped in a large Spanish cloak, and was sometimes in the habit of carrying a small lantern about him. On one occasion, he partially exhibited his masquerade in Balfour Fields and was closely pursued by a number of men in the employment of Mr. Giles, a coachmaster at Bow. But by the most extraordinary agility, and apparently a thorough knowledge of the locality of the place, he got clear off. The officer added that he was perfectly satisfied of the truth of the statement of Miss Alsop as to the violence inflicted upon her by the person she described. Indeed, the whole family, all of whom had seen him, agreed precisely in the description, but he differed in opinion with Mr. Alsop. There was more than one person. So this is an element I missed, that Alsop's, like Miss Alsop's father stated that he thought that there was a second accomplice because the perpetrator dropped his cloak in the process of fleeing, and the cloak later disappeared. So the detective also said that the situation of Mr. Alsop's house, being at a considerable distance from any other and in a very lonely spot, afforded ample opportunity for the ghost, as he was called, to play his pranks with impunity. But besides this, it was quite evident that the family were no strangers to him, as he was well acquainted with the name of Mr. Alsop. After the outrage was committed, it appeared, the family threw up the windows and called loudly for the police and assistance, their cries being heard at the John Bull public house some distance off. Three persons set out from thence in the direction of Mr. Alsop's, and on their way thither, they met a tall person wrapped up in a large cloak, who said as they came up that policeman was wanted at Mr. Alsop's, and they took no further notice of him. This person, he felt convinced, was no other than the perpetrator of the outrage himself. So the police got to work, and they interviewed a number of witnesses during this period. Around the same time, there are two further related accounts. The first of these other sightings occurred 5 days later, not far from the Alsop's residence, at a place called 2 Turner Street. So here, an individual wrapped in a large cloak knocked on the door of the residence. The master was not there at the time, but the door was opened by what was described as a serving boy. As he opened the door, the figure cast aside his cloak to reveal, quote, a most hideous appearance. But the boy reacted by letting out a series of loud screams, and unlike the previous encounter, the figure turned and fled, leaving the boy completely unharmed. Other than the fright, of course. The second of these encounters was considerably more serious, and it happened 3 nights later on the 28th of February. So this is all happening in like a week and a half period. It occurred at a location, again nearby, known as the Green Dragon Valley. So according to Lucy, she was returning home from her brother's house with her sister around 8:30 p.m. So this takes place in February, so this will be pitch black at the time. When they observed an individual standing in the passageway of the Green Dragon, the Green Dragon Valley, at an angle covered in a large cloak. So as they drew near, the figure spurted a quantity of blue flame right in Lucy's face, which blinded her and alarmed her to the point where she fell to the floor and was seized by fits for several hours. Their brother heard the commotion and ran to help, but by the time he arrived, his sister was cradling Lucy on the ground and the assailant had fled. So this is interesting because Lucy later describes the assailant as, quote, a tall, thin man who wore a headdress similar to a bonnet. That's quite similar to the previous account that we'd just seen of the Alsop residence. So these two other accounts were not really picked up by the press on the same level as the Alsop case. The Alsop case was like heavily covered by the Metropolitan Press during this period. In particular, Lucy's case was probably not, Lucy Scales' case was probably not taken up for the simple reason that she came from a poor background. So she was not kind of the reputable witness that the Alsop family was. So it seems like, going by kind of Carl Bell's account, the press may have placed less weight on her account as a result. Even so, James Lee did investigate the crime scene, and he commented that the alley was in an ideal spot to observe anyone coming from both distances. Around the same time, he also attended an experiment at London Hospital that confirmed that such a blue fire effect that was reported in both cases was possible to generate by, and I quote, blowing through a tube in which spirits of wine, sulphur, and another ingredient were deposited and ignited. So this again is very much the press's kind of perspective of it's some miscreant out causing trouble in effect. You know, and the kind of supernatural elements of the blue flame are explained away to some extent by this. In particular, the perpetrator asking Alsop for a light would make sense for this as well, because he needed something then to ignite his concoction by.
Yeah.
The investigation continues, and eventually their conclusion comes out that in her fright, the young lady had much mistaken the appearance of her assailant and that the whole affair was merely the result of a drunken frolic, and not the act of the individual who was stated to have made his appearance in different outlets of the metropolis in so many shapes. So again, trying to explain away the supernatural elements of this story.
Yeah.
So, Crofty, what do you think happens now from the investigation?
Well, if they've explained it away as a drunken frolic, then I imagine they would then just sort of drop it.
Yes, you might imagine that. Except Lee's investigation produces two suspects. First of these is a bricklayer by the simple name of Payne, and the second of this is a carpenter by the name of Milbank. These men were implicated by several witnesses at the time. In particular, they were implicated by a coach wheelwright by the name of James Smith. So, according to Smith, he was walking down the lane outside the Alsop's residence on the night in question when he heard screams coming from the residence. Further down the lane, he ran into Payne and Milbank, who were walking away from the house. So, in particular, he describes Milbank as wearing a white hat and a white shooting jacket, which is similar to the garment, let me see what it was described as down on here. The kind of like white oilskin garment that Jane Alsop described her attacker for wearing. In addition, he gives the following information. So as he was walking by, Payne said to the other, Milbank, "It was rascally. I would not have done it on any account," or words to that effect. "I was carrying my work on my shoulder at the time," so he means a wheel, "and they recognised me. And the man in the shooting jacket said, 'There's the blank.'" I don't actually know what was said there. Every single source I found just censored it. So I assume it was maybe a rude term or something like that.
Yeah.
"So there's the blank who was in the lane. He," meaning Milbank, "then came up to me and caught hold of the wheel I was carrying and pulled it off my shoulder, saying at the same time, 'What have you to say to Spring Jack?' I desired him to leave my wheel alone, and then Payne came and took him away. I went into the Morgan's Arms public house, and they followed me in and went into either the top room or the parlour. I inquired of the landlord who the man in the shooting jacket was, and he said that his name was Milbank, and that he resided nearly opposite to this house. I have no doubt that the man Milbank was the person who had so frightened the Mrs. Alsop." So, both of these men were taken in for questioning, but key point, they were not arrested. Upon being interrogated, both men denied any involvement, but Milbank said he was so drunk that night he had no recollection of anything that had happened. And, you know, we've all been there.
But I've not spat fire at anyone while in that state, as far as I know.
No, at least not either of us remember. The investigators, you know, this sounds like a bit of a slam dunk case, doesn't it? We have a witness that says that they were on the scene, that they were talking about this, they match the description, etc. And the main, like the principal suspect, which is Milbank, does not have a very good alibi, shall we say?
Yeah.
There are like other witnesses as well that implicated them, so it's literally not just you know, what's his name? It's not just James Smith's word against theirs. At this point, the authorities went back and related this to Jane Alsop and her sisters. Upon questioning, however, Jane Alsop and her sisters insisted that the man who assaulted her was definitely not drunk. And that's where we're going to leave it for this first episode.
Very well.
I think that's a nice organic stopping point.
Yeah.
Shall we say?
Should we add a dun dun dun?
Yeah. Insert stock sound effect. Yeah. So thank you guys for listening. I think we'll be back. I think we'll probably put this out in a couple of weeks' time. Let's split this up a little bit, I think.
Yeah.
Into a couple of episodes. So thank you, Crofty, for being here. We're kind of finishing at an interesting point, and I'm looking forward to hearing not only how this case evolves, but what you might have to say as to what was really going on.
Yeah, I'm quite looking forward to carrying on this discussion.
Yeah. So, everybody, stay tuned. Feel free to slowly gelatinize into the place where you're currently seated and wait the required 14 days or however long it is until we put the second part of this up.
Also, nice use of the word gelatinize.
Yeah, I wasn't sure where I was going with that one, I'll be honest. There were a range of attractive words I could have used, but then I, you know, it is a clean podcast. There's only so much vernacular I can throw in. So, yeah. Right, I'm going to end that there. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
And we'll talk to you again soon.
Yeah, goodbye.